Waltz. I'm the director of the Center for the Human Rights of Children here at Loyola University Chicago, and I want to welcome you all to our program here today entitled The Right to Be a Child, Human Trafficking as Child Soldiers and the Involved Youth. Our panel presentation is part of a month-long photography exhibit entitled Child Soldiers, Forced to Be Cruel. The exhibit features 40 photographs taken by talented and devoted photographers depicting child soldiers from around the world who have been manipulated by war criminals and subjected to unspeakable violence. These images are powerful reminders of lost childhoods. It is hard not to be affected by the deadly seriousness on the face of a gun-toting teenager. This internationally traveled exhibit has been shown in Rome, Italy, in Bonn, Germany, and the United Nations in New York City. Today, we're very excited to bring this exhibit to Loyola and to Chicago. While many of us, or some of us, I should say, may be familiar with the situations of children being conscripted into conflict as child soldiers, some of you may not be aware that child soldiering is also considered a form of human trafficking. Human trafficking occurs when someone is forced, coerced, or compelled to perform labor or services here, conscripted into conflict and war. One of our center's focus areas is child trafficking. Child trafficking is one of the greatest indignities against a person, with children being forced or coerced into forced labor, debt bondage, or suffering commercial sexual exploitation. When I began working at the center several years ago, I also became more involved in issues around youth violence. And I observed many parallels in these two worlds, youth engaging in criminal acts, many times with limited choice or agency, and the issues around child trafficking. In fact, one of the very first cases I worked on as an attorney was representing a young boy who was brought to the United States for the very purpose of being a drug mule. He was brought here by a family member to smuggle drugs across several states as part of a larger drug trafficking operation by a family member. There are several local, national, and international experts and scholars who assert that local children involved in gangs and conflicts on our streets are operating as child soldiers. And this provocative view raises several questions. How does the law look at children committing crimes coerced by adults who control them? How do we define children's agency in these situations, considering what we know about child development? How do we define conflict? When is someone a victim versus a perpetrator of a crime? And what does rehabilitation look like? And relatedly, how does trauma impact this issue? We hope to dig into these questions and these complex issues a bit more with our guests here today. So we'll spend about an hour, 15 to 20 minutes each, with each of our expert panelists today. And then we'll reserve time for questions at the end of the presentations. After the panel presentation, we invite you to stay for our reception, enjoy some refreshments, which you see around the room, and look at the artwork being presented. Out of respect and courtesy to our hosts here at the Damon Student Center, we ask that you keep all alcohol and food close to the exhibit and don't wander off or down the stairs or down the street with glasses of wine. We also have a number of resources on the table, including some of our And before I have the pleasure of introducing our guest today, I want to thank a few people and organizations for helping us with our program today. First, my amazing center staff, Adam Abershin, Dorothy McLeod, and Swapna Visipati, for graciously helping us with all the details for today. I also want to thank Brian Goodwin, the director of student centers, for graciously allowing us to display the photo exhibit and working out all the details, both difficult and minor, to ensure that the photos are available to students and the public during the time they are here for the exhibit. And both Brian and Swapna have also taken on curating duties, and that can be their next professional role in their next life. And finally, I want to thank our important university co-sponsors and partners in this endeavor: the Provost Office for Social Justice Initiatives, the Civitas Child Law Center at the School of Law, the School of Social Work, the Center for Urban Research and Learning, and for their commitment to social justice outreach and education programs like these at Loyola University Chicago. I now have the great privilege of introducing our guest speakers. They have amazing bios, very diverse and fantastic backgrounds, and most of those details are in your program. So I'll provide a shortened version, and we decided that I'm just going to read all of the bios right now, and then we'll just go in order of the program. So our first speaker is Julia Hicks. Ms. Hicks currently serves as a foreign affairs officer at the U.S. State Department, covering the Middle East as well as North and East Africa. In this role, Ms. Hicks is responsible for monitoring and researching human trafficking trends throughout these regions and drafting country assessment reports for the department's annual trafficking in persons report and traveling to these regions to conduct diplomatic engagement with foreign government officials. She'll be our first speaker. Our second speaker is Diana Tafur. Diana is a supervisor attorney at Heartland Alliance's National Immigrant Justice Project, Asylum Project, where she represents unaccompanied immigrant children as well as other asylum seekers. Prior to joining the National Immigrant Justice Center, she completed a year-long fellowship with Asylum Access in Ecuador, where she provided direct legal services to refugees and asylum seekers in discrimination cases and throughout all stages of refugee status determination processes, including presenting a petition before the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights. Our third speaker is Dr. Brad Stolbach. Dr. Stolbach, among many other roles, is a clinical psychologist with a focus on developing trauma-informed programs and services. He serves as a clinical director of Healing for People Chicago, a trauma-informed, hospital-based violence intervention model implemented in emergency pediatric settings in Chicago. He applies his work to a variety of settings, including the Adoption Center, the Pediatric Mobile Medical Unit, and the Center for Community Health and Vitality. Dr. Stolbach also co-directs a psychology clinic for youth on probation and is also an artist. His recent research activities focus on developmental trauma, disorder in urban children, cumulative trauma in young children, links between poverty and trauma, and the role of developmental trauma in the lives of children and youth affiliated with armed groups. Without further ado, Julie. Thank you.
And then I'll give you a country or a case example of the child soldiering problem and how we've worked with foreign governments to deal with this issue. So, okay, oh no, back, please, thank you. So human trafficking, what is the definition of human trafficking? Human trafficking is the act of recruiting, harboring, transporting, or obtaining a person for the purposes of labor or sex through, and this is important, through the use of force, fraud, or coercion. So for example, we see human trafficking crimes occurring in nearly every country around the world, in various sectors around the world. Women, men, women, and children can be victims of this crime. So we see people forced to work in sectors such as agriculture, construction, begging, factories, fishing, and many parts of the fishing sector, in fact, in domestic work as well, or people working as maids. We also see people forced into prostitution in the entertainment industry or in brothels. And we also see people who are both forced to labor and also forced into prostitution. So for example, I see women foreign in many of the Middle Eastern countries that I cover, I see foreign female domestic workers forced into forced to labor in domestic work or as maids in private residences. But I also see that they're forced into prostitution by their employers as well. So trafficking ultimately occurs in various forms in many sectors around the world. It is also a hidden crime and one that can be very difficult for law enforcement and judicial officials to detect, particularly because force, fraud, and coercion are not always visible immediately. Psychological coercion, for example, is something that, which is also an issue that we see with child soldiering. Is a very powerful tool that perpetrators use to keep their victims in situations of exploitation. The physical abuse, abuse that generally you can see visibly on someone's body, is not always the only indicator of trafficking. So child soldiering, which is really what we're here to talk about today, is a manifestation of human trafficking when it involves the unlawful recruitment or use of children, again, fraud or coercion by armed forces as combatants or other forms of labor. Some child soldiers are also sexually exploited by armed groups. So the perpetrators of child soldiering are many. The perpetrators can be governmental armed forces, they can be paramilitary organizations, they can be rebel groups, or even terrorist organizations. Children can be used as in direct hostilities as combatants, but children can also be forced to work as what we call support roles, so as cooks, guards, servants, messengers, spies, and the like. Girls can also be forced to marry or have sex with male combatants. It is also important to remember that the elements of force, fraud, or coercion do not need to occur at the point at which a child is recruited into an armed group. So any of these elements of force, fraud, and coercion can occur during the entirety of a child's victimization as a soldier. So for example, a child may willingly or appear to willingly join the ranks of an armed group. But once that child is a combatant, that child may be forced to do something that he or she would not ordinarily want to or choose to do. That child may also be coerced to do something through the use of threats to him or her, threats to his or her family. That child could be coerced through abuse or threats of abuse or retaliation. Psychological coercion, again, is also used by perpetrators of child soldiering to maintain a child in that armed group. So in many situations, it is unlikely that a child can freely leave an armed group once he or she enters that situation. So the child is ultimately forced to stay in an armed group. So let me use a case example, because I think going through definitions and that kind of thing is not nearly as interesting or easy to understand unless you use an actual case example or a country example. And I use the example of Syria and a little bit of Iraq as well, in part because I've been covering them for the last few years in my role in JTIP, but also because they are current conflicts and they're also emerging conflicts and evolving conflicts, I should say. And also the issue of child soldiering in these countries is also evolving. Front, as well as the Islamic State of Iraq and Levant, ISIL, are all using and recruiting children in the conflict in Syria. So for example, the Syrian army and its pro-regime militias are forcibly recruiting boys, some as young as 6 years old. Children are used as informants, which exposes them to retaliation and extreme punishment, including imprisonment and torture. Children are also used in direct combat and in hostilities, including as human shields, all of which is perpetrated by government forces. Undocumented child soldier cases of those by ISIL and al-Nusra, at least 25% of those children were under the age of 15, and some were as young as 8 years old. In July this year, for example, four boys fighting with al-Nusra participated in the beheading of four Syrian regime soldiers. ISIL also actively deploys children in hostilities, including coercing children also to behead Syrian regime soldiers, and using them also in direct combat roles. ISIL has deliberately targeted children for indoctrination and used schools for military purposes, thus endangering children, but also not allowing them access to their rights to education. ISIL also targets propaganda at children to foster a new generation of recruits. ISIL has established training camps where it instructs children, nicknamed the Cubs of the Caliphate, to operate weapons and to be deployed as suicide bombers. As reported by the UN Commission of Inquiry on Syria, children have been the victims, they have been the perpetrators, and they have been the witnesses of executions. In Raqqa City, for example, children are gathered for screenings of videos depicting mass executions of Syrian government soldiers, thus desensitizing them to extreme violence. So staying on the topic of ISIL, but moving to Iraq, ISIL also operates in Iraq and also forcibly uses and recruits children in much the same ways that it does in Syria, such as using children as bomb makers, as suicide bombers, and as informants. ISIL is also abducting women and children from minority groups in Iraq, in particular the Yazidi population, and forcing them to marry ISIL fighters for the purpose of sexual slavery, and in some instances, these women and girls are also forced into domestic servitude. These women and girls are also being sold to fighters in Syria as well, so we see that overlap there. These women and girls are considered to be victims of trafficking. The girls may also be considered to be child soldiers in that they are forcibly used for the purpose of sexual slavery by ISIL combatants. So again, I use those two examples here, but that is not to say that Iraq and Syria are the only places currently in the world where we're seeing the child soldier problem. We see it in many countries around the world in current conflicts. Just to name a few, we see child soldiers being used and recruited by both armed forces and, governmental armed forces and non-governmental armed forces in places like the Democratic Republic of the Congo, the DRC. We see child soldiers in Somalia, in Burma, Nigeria, Afghanistan, India. Truly, the list goes on. So I now, though, want to turn back to the work that JTIF and State Department as a whole is doing on the issue of child soldiering. The department works on child soldiering issues in two key ways. In two key ways, so through diplomatic engagement with foreign governments and also through the TIP report. So when it comes to diplomatic engagement, a few key offices in the department, including JTIP, my office, have regular dialogue with foreign governments that have child soldiering problems in their countries. And we also foster strong partnerships with the international community, such as our partnership with the UN, to work together on this issue. Through our engagement and partnerships, the department continually promotes the prevention of child soldiering. We promote the protection of child soldiers and access to adequate and appropriate protective services for children. And we promote the investigation and prosecution of those perpetrators, including government officials who are complicit in the use and recruitment of children into armed conflict. So through a mix of diplomatic engagement and partnership, we have in fact seen progress on the child soldier issue in some key countries. So for example, we have been working with the government of the DRC responses. So in a recent UN screening of 6,000 members of the Congolese army, the UN in fact found no child soldiers present. And the government has also taken steps to prosecute and convict Congolese army officials that are complicit in trafficking and in child soldiering. So these are excellent steps and ways that the government has, things that the government has done to begin to solve the problem of child soldiering. But this does not, however, mean that child soldiers are rid from the DRC. There are still rogue Congolese army elements that deviate from the government's official policy against the use and recruitment of child soldiers, and these rogue army elements are still, in fact, recruiting children into their ranks. This also, of course, does not mean that there are not non-governmental armed forces that are still using and recruiting child soldiers. So, though the government is taking very important steps, unfortunately, this is an issue that still plagues the country. So, moving on to another policy tool that the department uses to promote progress on child soldiering is through the DIP report, the Trafficking Persons Report. We acronym everything in the State Department. JTIP continually monitors and reports on trafficking and child soldier trends throughout the world, also working with NGOs and international organizations on this issue. And secondly, through the 2008 Child Soldier Convention Act, the CSPA, again, another acronym, the Secretary of State is required to identify countries that have governmental armed forces or government-supported armed forces that recruit and use child soldiers. The CSPA also requires that the TIP report list these foreign governments every year. So that's where our role comes in as well when we're drafting and producing the annual report. An important thing to note about this list is that a country may have child soldiers observed in that country, but if those children are not affiliated to the government of that country, that government may not be listed on the CSPA list. But the importance of the CSPA is that governments of CSPA-listed countries may not receive certain forms of U.S. military assistance in the fiscal year following their placement on the CSPA list. So there are, in fact, ramifications for countries based on the 2008 CSPA. I have seen, in fact, that the restrictions on assistance can have a powerful impact on governments' will to make progress on this issue. So I'll stop here, but I do want to reiterate that child soldiering and human trafficking are seen in many different places, in many different conflicts and contexts, and are perpetrated by varying types of people and groups. But ultimately, this crime that is inflicted upon children is extraordinarily detrimental to their well-being. And as some conflicts are resolved or dissipate, or if we look into the future of some conflicts such as that in Syria, when that conflict ends, it is important that we pay particular attention to the children that were forced to fight in these conflicts, both the boys and the girls, and ensure that they not only receive the appropriate psychosocial services, both the short and the long-term services, but that they are fully reintegrated into society to prevent the possibility of these children being re-trafficked in the future.
Impact change. We have over about 10,000 Columbus, Illinois. When the Asylum Project, which is my project, I'm going to speak specifically about my project, we see individuals from all over the world, including Africa, the Middle East, for example, the Congos, Cameroon, we see them also in Central America, and in Mexico. My project specifically deals with people that are fleeing persecution or have a well-founded fear of persecution, either because of their race, their nationality, their religion, their membership in a particular social group, or their political opinion. So for example, individuals who are fleeing family domestic violence type situations, a political opposition member, maybe in the Democratic Republic of Congo, individuals who identify themselves or are presumed to be LGBTQ individuals, as well as gang recruitment, gang resistance, if you will. Picking back on my co-panelist on the definition of child soldiery, one of the things that I wanted to bring to this panel today is the discussion of Central America, because in Central America, which includes Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador, we're seeing that it's one of the most dangerous regions for youth and women due to the high rates of homicide and the high impunity rates of these different crimes. What we're seeing is that these gangs, and there are two main gangs in this area, are the MS-13 or Mara Salvatrucha and Barrio 18, also known as Mara 18 or the 18th Street Gang. These are the two main gangs have really grown and gained a lot of control and power in these three different countries. And they've had a lot of influence. And just to give a little background about these different country conditions, I want to just talk about what these gangs are. These gangs have a particular hierarchy type structure of organization, where you have individuals divided into different cliques, so different micro groups, if you will, in different neighborhoods. And they have within these cliques different power structures of who is a boss or a jefe, and maybe to the lowest ranking, a collaborator, so someone that runs simple errands for the gangs. These gangs will have meetings every so often in that particular neighborhood, and occasionally they'll have regional meetings, and the bosses or the jefes will meet amongst each other and work to the top. These gangs have been reported to have connections with the Mexican cartels. The Mexican cartels has provided them with weaponry, and war-type weaponry, and you're going to see a couple pictures of some of the power that they have behind them, the armed power that they have behind them. What these gangs do in the territories that they create is, one, maintain them, two, grow them. Within these territories, they have set rules. These rules are punished if they are violated. They also go around the neighborhood charging a war tax, sometimes referred to as a fisto, or an extortion fee, sometimes how we refer to it here in the United States. They also have curfews. They also help mark their territories, and they rival with opposition gangs, also with law enforcement, in order to maintain control of these particular territories. Some of the politicians in these countries have referred to these different gangs as, or recognize that these different gangs have political incentives and sometimes act as political actors, just because of the things that they do in order to maintain their power. One of them is that there have been reports of these gangs infiltrating armed training, so they'll inscribe themselves into the armed forces to learn about their military tactics, as well as an opportunity to steal their different weaponry. What we're here to discuss today is how this prevalence of gang, the powers of these gang here in Central America, not here in Central America, but in Central America, as well as throughout the rest of the country, how it is that these armed groups affect the lives of children. In the Central American region, what we're seeing is that these gangs are specifically targeting youth. So anywhere as young as, from the clients that I've interviewed, 4 years old to 17-year-olds and even young adolescents in their early 20s and mid-20s. One of the reasons that they start going after these children so young is because the penalties for children are less. So why not have someone else do your bidding you not get in trouble for committing a crime, if you will, especially if you're treated differently under the law. Specifically, I wanted to talk about three of our clients at the National Immigrant Justice Center. One of them, who I'm going to call Pierre, whose name is not Pierre, is from Sierra Leone. He was a homeless youth who often had to sleep in churches or anywhere that he could find shelter with his mother. About age 9, he was forcibly recruited to fight for the rebel group, the Revolutionary United Front, the RUF, during their civil war. He had to survive 4 years of different horrific acts. It really started with a labeling. They took an iron label that had the letters RUF, put it on a hot plate, and made sure to brand him so that everyone knew who he was a part of. Then they made sure that they forced him to do drugs, made sure he was nice and high, so that when he was decapitating or cutting people's limbs off, maybe it didn't affect him as much as it would an individual that was at a different place emotionally and mentally health-wise. He was fortunately saved by the United Nations peacekeeping forces 4 years later, and he was brought back to his home village with other boys that had been rescued as well. What started happening is that the people in his town were very unhappy with the history of the country and started targeting these child soldiers. One of the individuals that he was released with was hung on a tree and punished for his quote-unquote collaboration with the rebel forces. Fearing that he was going to be next, he started his journey to the United States. In the Central American front, we have a young boy, Jose, from El Salvador. He was living in an MS-13, Manasalvachucha, territory. He grew up with these gangs. So you walk around as a youth and you see these walls covered in bullet holes. You see about dead bodies on the street about once a week, very normalized type violence in these types of communities. The gang members don't hide, they walk around and they make sure to have their presence known. And they greet him as he goes to school, as he gets off the bus, they hang out at school, they hang out at the soccer field. So when you're playing soccer with your local gang crew. But not by choice, just because of the power and control that they maintain in this territory. When he's young, and his friends are young, they offer them sneakers, a cell phone, food. Yeah, come hang out with us. Well, you know, we'll be your buddies, we'll be your friends. Our particular client always felt very uncomfortable around the gang members, so he tried to do the best that he could to avoid them. But unfortunately, as he got older, they grew more persistent, and it came to threaten him. They told him to run some errands, and if he didn't do so, they would either hurt him or his family. My client loves his family, so he did what he could to try and do what anyone would do to try and protect their family. So he obeyed. Initially, the requests were, okay, go give this note to, you know, Felipe over on 13th Avenue. Then it came, here's a cell phone, I want you to wait till someone calls you, and then I want you to deliver these drugs to this individual over there. And with each act, it started escalating, and then they started asking him to pick up extortion fees for business owners in the neighborhood. And he didn't like doing this because he felt the ever-presence of poverty in his neighborhood, and he wanted to stop, especially because he was in an impoverished neighborhood and didn't want to contribute to that. When he was asked and he came back empty-handed to his boss, he said, well, next time you need to hurt him. He went back to ask for the fee. The individual that store owner said, sorry, I don't have it. My client did not want to hurt him, came back, said, sorry, I took the money, but then I used it to buy food. So he got beaten up for 13 seconds. Incidents like this kept happening. At some point, they also branded him. They forced him to get a gang tattoo. They also started having him do drugs. It started out with marijuana, and fortunately it didn't escalate because he fled to the United States soon enough. He started out as that level of collaborator doing these errands, and it came time for his big initiation. He was going to kill his first person, and he was going to move up in the ranks. Very exciting for everyone else in the gang except for him. He didn't want to kill someone. He didn't want to have himself be killed by the gang, and he didn't want to bring harm to his family. So he came here to the United States. I have another client. She's a very wonderful young lady from Honduras. And she had a similar situation. She grew up on 18 territory in Honduras. And she was from a domestic violence type environment. Her stepmother used to beat her pretty regularly. So to find safety and some sort of control over her life, she tried to find any reason to not be at home, to avoid these types of beatings. Once outside in the street, of course, she caught the attention of Mara 18, or the 18th Street gang members. They started to ask her again to run errands. They gave her a cell phone. She started collecting extortion fees. But as the request grew, she again wanted to resist. But anytime she resisted, they would threaten her and her little sister. She was also forced to be a gang member's girlfriend. She was 16 at the time, and a mid-20-year-old gang member said, okay, you're my girlfriend now. We're gonna go out. We're gonna do this. And there wasn't an opportunity for her to say no. Fortunately, in my case, my client was not raped or passed around, but I have had other clients who are women who have been passed around to the gang for purposes of relieving their sexual tensions, if you will. When it got really bad and the threats kept augmenting, she told her family in the United States and she fled here. We're very fortunate that, I'm gonna call them Jose and Liliana, were able to escape these terrible situations. But for a lot of our clients, the flight isn't enough. A lot of them have to suffer more harm on their journey here to the United States. We have had a couple of clients who are raped on their trip here. They are beaten up and on their way here either by government officials or by Mexican cartels. And a couple of them have been kidnapped. Those that have been kidnapped are usually held in a bodega, which is kind of like an open space, small home. And in some of these instances, not all, they've been held in this space until the cartel decides to kill them, or they agree to backpack drugs into the United States. So we've had a couple of clients who, in order to flee their dangerous situation in their home country, are kidnapped by Mexican cartels in Mexico, held by force, and then told that they need to work as a drug mule. And therefore then forced to work as a drug mule. We've had clients that have also been forced into the sex trade industry once they're kidnapped, if you will, by the Mexican cartel in Mexico. Looking back at my colleague's comments or actual her definitions of what is a child soldier and what is a trafficking victim, I want you to look at these different instances. So, for example, you have trafficking is an individual who has been subjected to force, fraud, or coercion for the purpose of commercial sex, debt bondage, or forced labor. But if you look at our young boy from El Salvador, he did not want to work as a drug mule. He did not want to work as a lookout. He did not want to work delivering messages. And he definitely did not want to be forced to kill someone. But because they threatened to hurt him or his family, he felt forced to do so. The same for our young lady. She also did not want to work, being someone who told them when the police was coming or not, if they saw any opposing gang members coming into the neighborhood. But she also felt that she had no choice, and she definitely wanted to protect her family. Also, with the definition of child soldiering, which is any person below the age of 18 who is or has been recruited or used by an armed force or armed group in any capacity, including and not limited to fighters, cooks, porters, messengers, spies, or for sexual purposes. So when you look at these definitions and you look at these different countries, we want you to know that it does not just involve individuals who have participated in the actual hostilities, but who have been used by these armed groups in different ways to advance their cause. I'll stop here for now, and please ask me questions if you have any, and I'll pick it up.
Thanks, I'm actually gonna stand up here so I can see what I'm showing you. So I'm sure as you were listening to the first two speakers, some of you were thinking not about children in these other countries that they gave examples of, but thinking about children that you may know here in the city of Chicago. And so what I want to talk about a little bit today is the parallels between what we view as child soldiers in other countries and what we call the Chicago Tribune documented gang members. So here's just a couple of quotes from the Chicago Tribune. Two 17-year-old girls were hurt during a gang-related car crash. Two 17-year-old girls came out of the Honda, ran behind it. The driver of the Toyota then put his car in reverse and struck the Honda, which hit one of the girls and pinned the other. Both girls were taken to Advocate Illinois at the Sonic Medical Center. The girl who was pinned was stabilized. The girl had minor injuries. The two girls are documented gang members, police said. 15-year-old boy was shot in Englewood, authorities said. Around 12:50 a.m., the boy was in a parked car when someone opened fire, striking him in his arm. Estrada said he was taken to Holy Cross Hospital, where he is in stable condition. The boy was a documented gang member, and the shooting may have been gang-related, Estrada said. Now, have you seen those documents? I don't know where one gets those documents. But this is what our police force tells our reporters so they can write it in the paper about some of the children that are injured. And we did not plan this, but this is what Diana just said. This is the definition of a child soldier from the Cape Town Principles and Best Practices. I first started thinking about this in this way when I was at a presentation on child soldiers because of my interest in developmental trauma. That's what I do, that's my field. And they were talking about developmental trauma in child soldiers. And one of the speakers put this definition up. And I read it. And I said, I don't see the difference, really, between what's going on at home. So the way that we view our children has major implications for what we do. And the way we view a problem has major implications for what we think is the solution to that problem. So if we view children as criminals, then the solution is to put them into the criminal justice system, lock them up. We in America love to lock people up. There are some people who say that the military industrial complex has been replaced by the prison industrial complex. I don't think it's been replaced, I think it's just been complemented by since we're fighting. I don't know, how many wars are we fighting right now? Do you know the State Department? How many is the State Department saying we're fighting?
I don't think I can comment on that.
Sorry. We incarcerate more children than any other country in the world by far. And many of our children are classified by statute as adults. So the way that works is, if you're accused of certain crimes and you're over a certain age, then you are an adult. And you are then dealt with in the adult criminal justice system and get adult penalties for whatever it is that you did if you're found guilty. Now, you don't have to be proven guilty in order to be deemed an adult. It's that the law enforcement says you did something that made you an adult. And in Cook County, and it's true a lot of places, but we particularly like to lock people up who are black and brown. In Cook County, African-American youth are 46 times more likely than white youth to be incarcerated. 46 times. And that statistic comes from Cook County Circuit Court. So a colleague who actually was running that symposium where I first saw that slide has written about this, and this idea that we have in America our own version of child soldiers. And what she's saying is that we don't have to look to these other countries. We have children in our own backyards. And she says there are differences, clearly. U.S. youth are rarely forcibly abducted into gangs in the way that, you know, you hear about abduction, forced abduction. And she says, even in our most violent city environments, they don't match the levels of social, cultural, and physical disarray and degradation that characterize active war zones. But there are parallels, and I think we've heard some of those parallels already here today. The parallels I'm going to be talking about have to do with trauma and that, with the way that trauma shapes development and drives a lot of the violence that we see. So she says, gang-involved youth are compelled to witness, endure, and perpetrate acts of violence against others that leave them with the scars of trauma exposure, just as with child soldiers in Uganda, Sierra Leone, and Colombia. Emerging research suggests that gang-involved youth in the United States who perpetrate against others evidence the most severe symptoms of PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, and the most maladaptive outcomes. So she said, you know, in these, even in our most violent cities, she says, we don't have the conditions that we see in some of these other countries. But it's not going so great here. Right? So this is this year so far. We have in Chicago 387 homicides, 2,342 shooting victims. Our program for pediatric patients injured by violence, that's just two hospitals now. We receive about 20 referrals a month for young people who've either been shot, stabbed, assaulted, or witnessed a shooting or homicide. So I'm going to talk a little bit about trauma, developmental trauma, and this is some research on former child soldiers in Uganda that Fiona Clausen did. And so this is showing you the kinds of trauma that these children were exposed to. As you can see, they have very high rates of exposure to trauma. And then she looked at how many of them met the diagnostic criteria for post-traumatic stress disorder, a major depressive disorder, and a developmental trauma disorder. Now, developmental trauma disorder is a proposed diagnosis for what we call complex trauma. That's different from having a single traumatic experience that is horrible. It is about ongoing exposure to violence. And so what she found is that actually only a third of these children met the criteria for PTSD, which is what we tend to think about, right, with people exposed to combat. And about a third of them met the criteria for major depressive disorder, but almost 80% met the diagnostic criteria for developmental trauma disorder. And only 1% met the criteria for PTSD alone. So we have to be thinking about our children not just in terms of they've had a traumatic experience and now they have PTSD, but how their development has been shaped by what they've been through. So just a couple of basic assumptions about trauma. That is, trauma is something that overwhelms an individual's capacity to integrate experience in a normal way. And following exposure to trauma, if you don't integrate the trauma, the traumatic experiences get split off, and the individual alternates between functioning as if it's still occurring and functioning as if it never occurred. And so then, although trauma and memories and associations may be inaccessible to consciousness a lot of the time, they still have the power to shape our daily functioning behavior. I mentioned developmental trauma disorder. I'm not going to talk a lot about this, but the focus is on cumulative trauma and the developmental context in which exposure occurs, rather than on a discrete event. So the proposed criterion A, the exposure criterion for developmental trauma disorder, is that this happens over a prolonged period of time, and that there's direct experience and witnessing of repeated and severe episodes of interpersonal violence, and significant disruptions of protective caregiving as the result of, for example, repeated change of primary caregiver, repeated separation from primary caregiver, or exposure to severe and persistent emotional abuse. So when children grow up in situations where they're surrounded by violence and where their caregiving systems are unable to provide protection and care, it's not just PTSD that they develop. They develop really complex adaptations to what they've been through due to the things that they have to do to survive. And so the key developmental capacities that are affected by complex trauma, the ability to modulate, tolerate, or recover from extreme affect states, extreme feelings, regulating bodily functions, knowing what's happening inside yourself, knowing how to describe to somebody else what's happening inside you, the capacity to perceive threat, including reading of safety and danger cues, capacity for self-protection, self-soothing, the ability to initiate or sustain goal-directed behavior, a coherent self or identity, and the capacity to regulate empathic arousal, that is, when you're aware that someone else is having emotional response to something. So think about these things and think about the daily challenges that one faces in life, and then think about being a child in an environment where there is ongoing violence. So, my colleague Eddie Bokenever, how many here know Eddie Bokenever? Have you seen The Interrupters, anybody? Raise your hand if you've seen The Interrupters. If you have not seen The Interrupters, just go online and watch it on PBS Frontline, okay? So Eddie is one of the interrupters. He's now the director of Youth Safety Violence Prevention for YMCA Chicago. He's a social worker. So he asked kids in a group of his about what kind of trauma they had experienced. And this is what they reported. This is just basic survey information. These are the different kinds of trauma that they reported having experienced. So all of them, like in the example, said they had experienced both family violence and community violence. All of them had been exposed to ongoing violence. And they said, on average, the age when they first were exposed to trauma was 6 years. As a group, they averaged 10 different types of trauma they've been exposed to. That's not events, that's types of trauma. That could be literally hundreds or thousands of actual events. And then this is the other kinds of adversity that they reported that they had been exposed to. They averaged as a group almost three different types of other adversity: impaired caregiver, drug use, criminal activity, prostitution, or other issues like that in the home. So as a group, they averaged 13 different types of trauma adversity that they've been exposed to. And these children are around 13 and 14 years old. So I'm just going to talk about one of them, who we'll call Alfonso, who's 13 years old. He said, the hardest part about seeing my best friend die was watching him trying to breathe while he was turning blue and watching all of his blood run down onto the sofa. That was the third homicide that he had witnessed. And he held his friend while he died, 13 years old. This is a list of different types of trauma and adversity that this little boy experienced in his life. So on the right is what happened to him, on the left is the age he was when these things happened. So he's got 15 different types, again, including witnessing three homicides. This is the same information, but it shows you graphically where he was developmentally. How old was he? What else was going on? What was he dealing with at the same time in terms of trauma and adversity? The black line on this trauma history profile is the age that he became a child soldier. That is when he held a gun for his older brother when he was 8 years old. Now, a few years later, if he goes on to shoot somebody, he's now an adult, and he's charged as an adult, and he's going to get adult penalties and eventually be in adult prison. So, Eddie identified in the kids' histories some different trends. So he's, when he gathered this information, he's working a lot with Mexican-American kids, and so acculturation stress is one of the trends he identified. Also, half of the kids had at least one parent involved in a street organization or gang. Beginning in junior high, these kids began experiencing academic difficulty, presenting low attendance and high level of misconduct. The majority did not intend to complete high school. Now, you saw all the stuff these kids were dealing with, right? So why might they start to have academic difficulties? I don't know. And then the sense of identity built upon a reputation of behavior, and they all had experienced traumatic loss in the form of death, incarceration, or deportation of a close friend or family member. So part of this also is not just what happens to individuals, but what we do to the communities and the families in which these individuals live. And if you hear about other countries where children are recruited into armed groups, one of the things that's consistent is that the family systems have been broken down and the community systems have been broken down. In this country, we have systematically broken down the African-American family system since the day we started bringing African people here as property. And we continue to do that in all kinds of ways. So this is from my colleague John Rich, who developed the Healing Hurt People model, which is the model that we are using with violently injured children in Chicago. And he's done a lot of work on people who are injured, young black men in particular. So if you want to read a good book about this, read his book. It's called Wrong Place, Wrong Time. What he says is that a high level of violence in their communities makes young men feel physically, psychologically, and socially unsafe. Physically, young men have been shot, stabbed, or attacked, fear that unless they arm themselves, someone else might attempt to harm them as they have been injured before. Psychologically, they are left with the hypervigilance and disruption that come from trauma. Socially, they have often been raised in communities where there is a shared idea that if you fail to defend yourself when challenged, you become a sucker, which will lead other people who now believe you are weak to take advantage of you. So, and Diana talked a lot about this, that people feel like they had no choice, right? The children that you talked about felt they had no choice. They're damned if they do, they're damned if they don't, right? Sadly, because of their social position and legacy of violence, racism, and poverty into which they've been born, they've become, for many of us, strange icons of fear. Each time a shooting or a stabbing or an assault is reported in the news, the details obscure a young man with a story, a young man with real blood running through his veins. And that's one of the reasons, there are others, but that's one of the reasons that we like to put in the paper that this person is a documented gangbanger, right? So this is the cycle of violence that John is describing. And what he's saying is that trauma is driving all the violence, right? So essentially, you have people exposed to trauma that causes adaptations. They get post-traumatic stress disorder, acute stress disorder, or what I describe, developmental trauma disorder. Then adapting to that, they self-medicate and or get weapons. And that increases their risk for injury or re-injury or retaliation, which increases the likelihood that they're going to end up dead or in jail. If they don't end up dead or in jail, then they may get injured. They go to the hospital, they get treated in the hospital, they patch them up, they send them home, and then it just keeps going, right? No help for what they've been through. So I showed you some of Eddie's survey data. This is data from a little bit older young people. These are people between the ages of 17 and 26 who we locked up in our juvenile prison system, which we call youth centers, the Illinois youth centers. Those are prisons for children, in case you didn't get that. So this is kids in a program that Storycatchers Theater runs called Changing Voices. It's an aftercare program. And this is their trauma histories that they reported. Their average age of first trauma exposure was 4 years, 4 months. 100% of them experienced at least one form of ongoing traumatic stress. 5 of them saying that there had been one stressor that was present for their whole life. So as a group, they average almost 7 different types of traumatic stress. They also averaged almost 5 by the age of 18 different types of other adversity, including incarceration, loss, substitute or foster care, et cetera, et cetera. So as a group, just like Eddie's kids, they're averaging almost 13 different types of traumatic stress, other adverse childhood experiences. If you go into prison, kid prison or adult prison, doesn't matter, unless you go, well, I'm not going. The politicians go to a different prison. But if you go to prison and you get these histories, you will get the same histories from everybody that we lock up. So these guys, I was able to ask them, guys and young women, about their own use of weapons or violence or gang affiliation. And four of them reported that they had inflicted a violent injury on someone, and they reported their average exposure was 16. Four of them reported they had carried a gun for protection. Their average exposure was almost 17 different types of trauma. Two-thirds of them reported having a family member affiliated with a gang or street organization. And that's the definition of coercion, force. When you have family involved and you're going into the family activities, where does that fit? And four of them said that they had been affiliated with a gang or street organization, and the ages that they said they first affiliated were 9, 12, 14, and 16. So that's what I have to say, and I'm really interested in hearing what else you all have to say and what you all have to say about it.
Thank you. Those are all very powerful presentations. Before we open up the floor to Q&A, I want to invite a guest here today who's a former student of mine, an alumni from the Loyola School of Law, Christina Risen, who published a paper entitled "Are Juvenile Gang Members Victims of Labor Trafficking?" in the Children's Legal Rights Journal published by the Civitas Child Law Center at Loyola, to reflect on the comments made today and maybe talk a little bit about some of the things that you discuss in your paper. So just for a couple minutes, Christina.
Juvenile gang members, obviously, as labor trafficking victims, based on a comparison with both domestic sex trafficking victims as well as child soldiers. The crucial question for the domestic labor trafficking victims, for the domestic labor trafficking question with respect to juvenile gang members, is the question of voluntariness. People like black and white, good, evil kind of dichotomies when it comes to violent crime. And children who are involved in gangs end up on the short end of that stick. But as we've heard today, voluntariness and coercion are very complicated questions. The family involvement in a gang is a coercive element. The incremental nature of the actions that the children are asked to perform blurs the line between when the coercion actually begins. And as Ms. Hicks said, the coercive moment is not necessarily the moment when the recruitment occurs. These are all issues that complicate whether children were responsible, like ultimately responsible in such a way that we have to punish them and send them to jail, or if they are simply injured people who need services. I obviously come down on the side of these are injured people who need services. And one huge issue for me personally is that when we talk about juvenile gang members, especially the so-called documented juvenile gang members, this is really dangerous because one of the factors that is considered in transferring children from juvenile court to adult court is whether they're involved in a gang. So they don't even have to be criminally involved with the gang. They don't have to have a criminal record with a gang. It can still cause them to be moved into adult court. Those are just a few points that I discussed in my paper. Thank you for this time. I really appreciate Christina being available to talk about her paper.
but I think it also is a demonstrated example for the other students in the room about some of the work and research and advocacy you can do on issues like this and those that are related. I have a couple of questions, but I want to open up the floor now to those of you who may have questions for our esteemed panelists. We do have microphones in the corner of the room, so if you have questions, if you can just come up to the microphones so that way we can hear you. In the interim, while those of you who are mustering up courage to ask questions that you have, or maybe even make comments on what you've heard today, I wanted to ask a question for both Diana and Julie. What are the legal protections that exist for these youth from your respective experiences?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think if people are identified as victims and there are systems set up in place to protect trafficking victims, then there are legal protections for them. But if not, they're often treated as criminals.
So it sounds like there's two layers of challenges, and one is the identification as a victim versus a perpetrator, and also what are the available remedies depending on their status, and also the state of the legal systems and rule of law in those applicable areas. Moving away from legal protections, and that's, oh, here we go, we have a question. Go ahead, it's your turn.
I'm just curious to you.
Can you speak in the microphone, please?
How does the state department build their report? Like, how does the data acquire? Like, what is that process? Since it's really hard to get accurate data, I'm wondering how.
Great question, and I was prepared to answer that because many people ask that question, and I've gone through about 4 reports so far in my work at JTIP. So, yeah, we use a wide variety of sources to collect information on the 188. So we use government data from the foreign governments that we are reporting on, if they are able and willing to provide us information. But we also look toward NGOs and international organizations also to provide us information. And of course, we want to make sure that those sources of information are accurate and that we can verify them in other ways as well, to make sure that they're corroborated information. We also sometimes use the media, because journalism is a very reputable source of information. And sometimes, in some ways, governments, I've seen some governments actually using their own media, the media in their own country, to help them report on their own, the trafficking situation in their own countries, which is a pretty positive thing to see some countries or governments working with media. That's not as common in the countries where I work in the Middle East, but we do see that in other countries around the world. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Have you seen any trends, like some part of the year that there's more like recruiting or like something like that?
You mean like changing trends and
yeah.
Tracking? Well, yes. And I guess I'll just speak to the countries that I cover, since I don't cover the whole world, thank goodness, because that would be quite a task. but I cover about 18 countries, and yeah, we do see some emerging issues. I will say for the countries that I cover, I look at the refugee, the Syrian refugee situation, and the countries to which the Syrians are fleeing. So I don't cover Europe, and that I know is a major issue right now in the media, if y'all are following that. But I do, which I'm sure you are. But I have been looking for the last couple of years at the Syrian refugee situation, or the situation for Syrian refugees in countries like Jordan, Lebanon, Turkey, and to a certain extent, Iraq. And yeah, there are some emerging trends in that regard. Because they are a very vulnerable population. So we've been watching to see where, you know, in what ways might they be, in what ways they may be vulnerable. In some countries, you might not think this, but, you know, in some countries, Syrian refugees are a little bit more
rescued by UN safe peacekeeping forces. What does that look like when gang members are quote unquote rehabilitated and brought back to communities in Chicago?
It doesn't look like anything because we don't do it. We lock people up and then we let them out. That's about it. So I even made a note when you use the word reintegration, when I wrote it down here, reintegrated, because what does it mean to be reintegrated when so many of the systems are broken down already? So it's a very good question, and it's what we really need to be thinking about, not just with our children, but with anyone that we're locking up. What does it do to someone, whatever they've been through to the point before we lock them up, to lock them up, and then what do we expect them to do when they get out? The number one most important thing that most of our youth want, who've been injured, is a job. The number one thing that most people want if they've been locked up and they're getting out is a job. And we have a lot of things put in place to make sure that they can't get a job. So, sadly, I don't have much of an answer for you, but it's an excellent question. It's one we all need to be thinking about.
Can I ask my question?
Mm-hmm.
Dad, can you talk about Project Fire?
Okay. it's a good segue to it.
Yeah.
So there are some flyers, thank you, Eva. Eva is part of the Project Fire team. So Healing Hurt People Chicago has kind of offshoot, which just finished a pilot program. It's called Project Fire. It combines glass blowing, glass arts education, mentoring, and trauma psychoeducation. And the youth in the program work for us over the time that we did this pilot program, and they will be showing and selling their work on October 21st at the Hyde Park Arts Center from 4 o'clock to 7:30. So I know it's the other side of the world, but some of us live there, and please feel free to come down to our neighborhood on Wednesday, October 21st. Thank you for setting that up. Oh, you want me to talk about what we do in Project Fire?
Yeah.
Okay. Project Fire is a glass artist who's a lead instructor, and then we have two assistant instructors, mentors, both of whom have dealt with a lot of violence in their lives. One was shot in the head and partially paralyzed when he was 15 years old. The other was not ever shot, but he was violently injured in other ways and witnessed a lot and lost people to homicide. And both of them have really, through glass and art, that's been their main, I think, in a lot of ways, their main therapy and the way that they've found some meaning in their lives. And so both of them are instructors for this program, and then we have four youth who've been injured by violence, several of them have been shot, one witnessed the homicide of his little brother, and they learned to blow glass and make stuff, and then we also do have what's called a self group. Itself is the psychoeducation model and healing group. People itself stands for safety, emotions, managing emotions of loss and letting go, and future. So these are groups that are semi-structured, really setting up conversations about these central issues that are central for most people who've been dealing with a lot of violence. So that was, I tried to do that quick.
You did a great job. Thank you for sharing that with us. I think we have time for one more question.
Thank you for your presentations today. Appreciate this. The point that you made about labeling, I couldn't agree with you more. The labeling has implications, and can't agree with you more that there's a problem with incarcerating so many people. My question is incarceration ever appropriate? And if so, what would be some indicators that it would be?
You want to ask the lawyer or the psychologist? The current system that we have is completely broken. So it's even impossible to answer the question because it's purely a hypothetical question. The system is so unfair, it's so tilted against people who have no money, who belong to marginalized or oppressed populations, that it can't serve any good purpose. Now, how we fix that, that's a big question. But whether incarcerating people is a way to deal with the fact that humans are violent, you know, it hasn't been working very well. So that'd be my answer to your question.
Can I just follow up?
Yes.
If I understand that, and I don't have a solution to propose, but do you have ideas as to how do we engage with these youth, and yet in some ways have methods to restrain repetitive violent behavior while we're trying to understand, as John Rich said, their stories and
most people that I know don't want to hurt anybody. They don't want to hurt themselves, and they don't want to hurt other people. If they are doing things that are harmful, they're doing them usually because they believe that they're doing the right thing, or they believe they don't have any other choice. Many of them also believe they have no future whatsoever, and so there's no reason to do anything different because it doesn't matter anyway. So I think the idea that what we're dealing with is bad behavior is actually the wrong idea. And so the way that you feel that people are not acting the way human beings ought to act, then the place to start is to treat them like human beings. And that's essentially what healing hurt people tries to do. Now, can we succeed with everybody? No, but if we succeed with a fraction of people and we change the trajectory around, we save millions of dollars. And so I want to come back to the first part of your question also, which is locking people up is benefiting a lot of people. There are corporations making billions of dollars on this industry. And so the same way that our youth who are being trafficked, labor trafficked, somebody's making money and it ain't them. We have the same issue at a structural level. There's money being made. And we're spending all of this money that keeps these problems going. So we need to think about what we want and what we want our resources to go towards.
Thank you. I think we'll have some more time for some informal Q&A during our cocktail reception after the panel presentation. I want to thank our esteemed panelists for all of your perspectives, both global, regional, and local. I think we've learned a lot today, particularly I think in one of the final comments about these labels. For us to walk away today not just thinking about these ideas as child soldiers, child combatants, victims of labor trafficking, gang members, but primarily as children and as human beings, and applying that framework to this conversation. and we at the Center for the Human Rights of Children and our partners through this program on today, encourage you all to think about this, to reflect on this, to talk about it, to share what you learned today with your family, your colleagues, your students, your friends. Think about research projects to address some of these larger issues. And also on a personal note, I think it's wonderful to see many of you who have brought your family members here, your children, young and tall, your spouses, your partners, and we love seeing families and community members attend our events here at Loyola. So welcome again to you all. Please enjoy our reception. And thank you very much again for your panelists.
It's like, where'd everyone go?
But no, but I am open to this idea. And okay. It, you know, the thing is, it takes time. And when you're younger, then you have your family. Has to be very careful. It's very doable. It's odd how talented. It always surprises me that you really, once you let them go,
or even the fact that people realize that they have a choice. You know, I think that's the hard part, is people will like look to the mind and it's like,
but you're the people you love.
I would, you know,
I think you must get to it. So,
where do you take it from? Roosevelt?
Downtown.
Yeah, downtown. Yeah. That's easy. This goes right here.
That's nice.
And then you could also go to your parents and
it's in the
So
I get it. I didn't want to talk about this.
Well, that is, no.
For a while because of what was going on over there. And he got out, but now he's a job and he's in the apartment. He was comfortable because he was like fine, eating drugs or whatever. But then
why we're not doing better as a nation, because I do think we're going to be better science.